Welcome. Welcome to the We Robot Party. We have quite a show for you tonight. I think you're gonna like it. As you can see, I just arrived in the robotaxi. There's 20 more where that came from. So they've been traveling. They're all, there's no people in them, as you can see. The car's just going by with no people. So you see a lot of sci-fi movies where the future is dark and dismal, where it's not a future you wanna be in. You know, like, I love Blade Runner, but I don't know if we want that future. I think we want that that duster he's wearing, but not the the bleak apocalypse. We want to have a fun, exciting future that if you could look in a crystal ball and see the future, you'd be like, yes, I wish I could be there now. So when we think about transport today, there's a lot of kind of pain that we take for granted that we think is normal, like having to drive around LA in like 3 hours of traffic. Yeah, and people that live in LA, I mean, you know, try to get from Pasadena to El Segundo during rush hour. It's like, you can fly to another city faster than you can get to cross town LA. And you have to drive the whole way. Unless you're in a Tesla, of course. Now, Tesla already does quite well at this supervised self-driving. So supervised full self-driving is actually working quite well. I'm sure there's people in the crowd, you're using that. So we'll move from supervised full self-driving to unsupervised full self-driving, where the car, you could fall asleep and wake up at your destination. But there's also a challenge for a lot of people that cars cost too much. I mean, when you factor in everything that goes into a car and the car insurance and the car payments and the storage of the car, it's very expensive. So with, and you say, like, how often are, what, how many hours a week are cars used? Your average passenger car is only used about 10 hours a week out of 168 hours. So the vast majority of the time, cars are just doing nothing. But if they're autonomous, they could be used, I don't know, 5 times more, maybe 10 times more. So you could actually, for the same car, would have 5 times as much value, maybe 10 times as much value. There's 168 hours in the week, and like I said, only 10 of them are used for driving. So, and then a bunch of those hours are looking for a parking spot. With autonomy, you get your time back. This is a very big deal. So it's not just a save, like, it'll save lives, like a lot of lives, and prevent injuries. I think we'll see autonomous cars become 10 times safer than a human. You can think of the car in an autonomous world as being like just a little lounge. You're just sitting in a comfortable little lounge, and you can do whatever you want while you're in this comfortable little lounge. And when you get out, you will be at your destination. So, in fact, I think the cost of autonomous transport will be so low that you can think of it like individualized mass transit. The average cost of a bus per mile for a city, not the ticket price because that is subsidized, but the average price is about $1 a mile. Whereas the cost of cybercab, we think probably over time, from the operating cost is probably going to be around 20 cents a mile. And price, including taxes and everything else, probably ends up being 30 or 40 cents a mile. We expect the cost to be below $30,000. And I think there'll be an interesting, you know, business model where, like, let's say somebody is an Uber or Lyft driver today, where they can actually sort of manage a fleet of cars and, like, a sort of manage, I don't know, 10, 20 cars and just sort of, you know, take care of them like a shepherd tends their flock. I think that'll be pretty cool. I think it's going to be a glorious future. It's going to be really something special. We do expect actually to start fully autonomous unsupervised FSD in Texas and California next year. That's with the Model 3 and Model Y. And then we expect to be in production with the CyberCab, which is highly optimized for autonomous transport. Well, I tend to be a little optimistic with time frames. In 2026, before 2027, let me put it that way. And we'll make this vehicle in very high volume. But well before that, you will experience a robotic taxi via the Model 3 and Model Y program. And Model S and X too, your 3 and Y will achieve unsupervised full self-driving wherever regulators essentially approve it in the US and then to follow in outside the US. So, and Cybertruck too, yes, of course, sorry, I don't want to forget, yes, all our cars, basically, all cars that we make. So one of the reasons why the computer can be so much better than a person is that we have millions of cars that are training on driving. So it's like living millions of lives simultaneously and seeing very unusual situations that a person in their entire lifetime would not see. So with that amount of training data, it's obviously going to be much better than what a human could be, because you can't live a million lives. And it's also, it can see in all directions simultaneously, and it doesn't get tired or text or any of those things. It will naturally be, like I said, 10, 20, 30 times safer than a human, just for all those reasons. And I want to emphasize that the solution that we have is AI and vision. So there's no expensive equipment needed. The Model 3 and Model Y and SNX that we make today will be capable of full autonomy unsupervised. And that means that our cost of producing the vehicle is low. Now, we are going to actually overspec the computer for the Cybercab. So our AI5 computer will be somewhat overspec'd. Because I think there's actually also an opportunity, sort of like an Amazon Web Services, where if the car is driving for 50 hours a week, there's still over 100 hours left. There's a potential there to have a massive amount of distributed inference compute, where if you've got, like, say, a fleet of 100 million vehicles and a kilowatt of efficient inference compute, you have 100 gigawatts of compute, which is really quite substantial. So our autonomous future is here. Something we're also doing is, and it's really high time we did this, is inductive charging. So the robotaxi has no plug. It just goes over the inductive charger and charges. One of the things that is really interesting is how will this affect the cities that we live in? And when you drive around a city, or when the car drives you around a city, you'll see there's a lot of parking lots. There's parking lots everywhere. So what would happen if you have an autonomous world is that you can now turn parking lots into parks. So there's a lot of opportunity to create green space in the cities that we live in. What happens if you need a vehicle that is bigger than a Model Y? The Robovan. We're going to make this, and it's going to look like that. Now, can you imagine going down the streets and you see this coming towards you? So this can carry up to 20 people, and it can also transport goods. So you can configure it for goods transport within a city, or transport of up to 20 people at a time. The Robovan is what's going to solve for high density. So if you want to take a sports team somewhere, or you're looking to really get the cost of travel down to, I don't know, 5-10 cents a mile, then you can use the Robovan. One of the things that we want to do, and we've seen this with the Cybertruck, is we want to change the look of the roads. You know, the future should look like the future. Everything we've developed for our cars, the batteries, power electronics, the advanced motors, gearboxes, the software, the AI inference computer, it all actually applies to a humanoid robot. It's the same techniques. It's just a robot with arms and legs instead of a robot with wheels. And we've made a lot of progress with Optimus. And as you can see, we started up with someone in a robot suit, and then we've progressed dramatically year after year. So you can have your own personal R2-D2 C-3PO. And I think at scale, this would cost something like, I don't know, $20,000, $30,000. Probably less than a car is my prediction long term. So, and what can it do? It can do anything you want. So it can be a teacher, babysit your kids, it can walk your dog, mow your lawn, get the groceries, just be your friend, serve drinks, whatever you can think of. And I think this will be the biggest product ever of any kind. Because I think everyone of the 8 billion people of Earth, I think everyone's going to want their Optimus buddy. And there's going to be maybe two. And then they'll be producing products and services. I predict, actually, provided we address risks of digital superintelligence, 80% probability of a good outcome, the cost of products and services will decline dramatically. Basically, anyone will be able to have any products and services they want. It will be an age of abundance, the likes of which people have almost no one has envisioned. It'll be something special. Let's party!